إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا وقائدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم تنزيله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. All the praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our master, our sustainer, our provider. We thank him, we seek his forgiveness, and we ask him for his divine guidance. May the peace and blessings and salutations be upon our noble prophet, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions, and all those who have chosen to follow the path of righteousness until the day of resurrection. As to what is to follow, my dear brothers and sisters in Al-Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having guided us to the path of Al-Islam. For if it is not for the guidance of Allah, we would not have been Muslims. And we need to continue to make dua every single day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps us on the straight path until the day that he takes our souls. May Allah keep us on the Siratul Mustaqim. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters in Al-Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen and sent as rahmatan lil alameen, as mercy for the entire humanity, he guided us, took us from the darkness of ignorance to the light of Al-Islam. He never gave up. He admonished the people by day and by night, in small groups and in large crowds. He spoke to the elderly and to the young people. He spoke to people who hated him and hated his beliefs. He spoke to people who were close to him, people from distant places. Because he wanted khayr for them, he wanted goodness for them. And the goodness that me and you are looking for is the Jannatul Firdaus al-A'la. May Allah make us among those people who will dwell the Jannah. And so from time to time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will use every given opportunity to talk to the companions, to advise them in a one-to-one situation and in a group situation. Like Irbad ibn Sariyah, who says that we were sitting in a crowd and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he admonished us, he spoke to us, he talked to us. It was maw'idha baligha. It went deep into our hearts. We were crying when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was talking to us. And we said to him, O Messenger of Allah, as if this is a departing advice. And then the Prophet ﷺ advised them. He said, I advise you to keep strong upon the Kitab and the Sunnah. For if you leave after me, you shall see a lot of differences. This was a group advice. But then we see again the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam giving one-to-one advice, individual advice. like Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was sitting at the back of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, riding, and the Prophet says to him, Ya Ghulam, O young man, ittaqillaha haythuma kunt, fear Allah, wherever you may be. Wherever you are, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the core of belief, and this is the foundation for every Muslim. Fear Allah wherever you may be. You do not have to fear Allah in one instance and not fear Allah in the other. To have continuous God consciousness is what will guide you to Jannah. To be aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-raqib, He watches over you, this makes you live a better life. To remember that Allah has appointed angels to write what you do, what you say, where you go, it makes you live a happy life. And so also we see in another beautiful advice that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave to one of the companions, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This hadith which is narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised Abu Dharr. And he says to him, اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس. He says, oh Abu Dharr, the Prophet spoke to him, he addressed him, and he says, take advantage of five things before five. Take advantage of five things before five. When we say someone takes an advantage of something, normally and naturally, it is something that you do without feeling a pain or a pinch. It is something normally that you would do and reap of benefits and gain. It is something that you do that will raise you and give you advantage. This is called an opportunity. You have an opportunity to do something, so don't miss the opportunity. And interestingly, when we talk of opportunity, sometimes they come and go. You don't get the chance again to get that specific opportunity. So once you have it in front of you, you should take full advantage of the opportunity to do what is required of you. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to him, take advantage of five before five. He says the first one, shababak, your youthhood, qabla haramik, before you become an old person. Islam has given a lot of attention to young people, just like every nation has done with its young nation. Because the young people, they are the leaders of our time. They are the people who will take the da'wah forward. They are the people who the ummah has hope that will carry the mission of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reflect and see what the young people did. We all know of the young ambassador of Islam, Mus'ab ibn Umair, the young companion who embraced Islam. He has forsaken the wealth of the dunya, who was living a luxurious and comfortable life. But when he embraced Islam, his parents were not too happy with him. They wanted him to desert the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his da'wah. But he says, I have chosen to follow the truth. I want to be on this path. He was deprived food, clothing, and the luxury that he used to live in. But he chose to follow the truth. And so he took the opportunity, and because of this, he made his mark by being appointed as the first ambassador of Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose him and sent him to Medina to go and teach the people of Medina. Young man, there were older people who embraced Islam, but this young man dedicated his time to be with the Prophet, to learn from the Prophet, and then he was sent to a different city to go and teach people about Islam. We all hear about Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anh, a young companion who learns the Quran, who we see every book of tafsir mentions the name of Ibn Abbas. Why? Because he dedicated his time to seek knowledge and then to propagate knowledge. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he passed away, Ibn Abbas, who was a relative of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to one of his companions, "Come, let us go and study under the big and great companions of Medina." This companion said, "You are a relative of the Prophet. You don't need to go anywhere. Sit down. They will come to you. You sit and wait for them." But no, he says, this knowledge, it is something that you work for. It is not something that comes to you. And this is where the Arab saying comes from. When they say, "Al-ilmu yu'ta wa la ya'ti." This knowledge, it is something that is given to you. It's not something that will come to you. You seek it, you find it, you get it. And so we see him. He is one of the greatest scholars of all times in Islam. He is called Hibrul Ummah, the ink of the nation. He was a young person. And so also Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah, who is the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. He is among the greatest fuqahas of Medina. Why? A young companion who also lived at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he and his father, they also, the Prophet, they believed in him, they learned from him. He took the advantage of being a young man with an open mind and brain and learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He went in pursuit of seeking knowledge, attaching himself with the great companions of the time. They took the advantage. My dear brothers and sisters, this youth, this age, we're not talking just about teenagers. We're talking about each and every one of us who has the means, who is strong, who is fit to do what it takes to improve themselves with knowledge, or to improve themselves in their ibadah, or to improve their relationship with others, or to do something to promote the deen. You are part of this call. You are all required to answer this call. And this is why we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you a special place, Yawm al-Qiyamah, amongst the seven people whom will be shaded under the shade of Allah, Yawm al-Qiyamah, when there will be no shade except His own shade, will be Shabun Nasha'a fi Ibadatillah, a young man who grew in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A young man who has dedicated his time to seeking knowledge. A young man who has been in the masjid. A young man who practices Islam to the best of his ability. And don't forget, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also told us in another hadith, لَنْ تَزُولَ قَدَمَ عَبْدٍ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حَتَّى يُسْأَلْ عَنْ أَرْبَعٍ. You will not move an inch, a space, on the day of judgment, the day of reckoning, when we stand for judgment and accountability, you will not move until you are asked about a number of things. And among these things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, he says, "Al-shababihi fima afna." Your youth, when you are young, when you are strong, what did you do with that time? What did you do with that time? Did you engage yourself with beneficial things? Did you engage yourself by learning the deen? Supporting and working with your parents? Doing things that are beneficial to community and society? Or did you become someone who is so mischievous? Someone who is disobedient to their parents? Someone who does not want to listen to what elders will say to him? Someone who does not want to become someone successful for themselves and for their community? You have to ask yourself this question. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said to all of us, "Ihris ala ma yanfa'ak, wasta'in billah wa la ta'jaz." Three words or three phrases, keep them in your mind. Ihris ala ma yanfa'ak. Make sure you pay attention and you engage yourself with things that will benefit you. With things that will benefit you. Ihris ala ma yanfa'ak. Wasta'in billah, and seek help from Allah. We know sometimes life can be challenging, it can be tough. You want to do things, you want to learn, you want to pray, you want to be a good person. Shaitan comes with the waswasa. This is why you have to turn to Allah and ask Allah for guidance and make dua. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us and has taught us after every salah. What did he say we should say? Allahumma a'inni على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. You make dua after your salah. Even the Prophet ﷺ used to do it. So why can't you do the same thing? So if you think there are distractions around the side, then you should make dua. Talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَعْجَزْ. Don't you give up. Don't give up. Continue. Be steadfast. Have we ever seen a successful leader who does not go through struggles? No. In life, for you to succeed, you must work hard. There's no magic about it. We all know this. If you want to become a successful businessman, you have to work hard. 8 to 8, some people work because they want to succeed in their business. You want to become an outstanding student, you have to work hard. You don't wait until 1 month to the GCSE exam and then you start revising. You're not going to have A stars and A's. You have to start as early as possible. You work hard in preparation for that. Don't give up. This is the advice of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The hope and the ummah is looking forward to you, the young people, so that we can all make our contribution, so we can all work to elevate this deen. Remember, if we all decide not to do anything, Allah can replace us and bring people who will obey Him and who will take the da'wah forward. So that's the first advice that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he gave to Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then he said to him, your health before your illness. Sihatuk, your health, which we take for granted. You wake up in the morning, you can see, you can talk, you can walk, and you don't even say Alhamdulillah. You just go and you start mourning. I didn't get this, I didn't get that. You forget about what you have. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لِرَبِّهِ لَكَنُودٍ. Mankind indeed, you are ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You forget that Allah has said to you, وَلَئِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you are grateful, you show gratitude, I will increase my favors upon you. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised you. And Allah, when He promised, He fulfills His promise. My dear brother, when was the last time you've been in a hospital? When is the last time you visited someone who is sick? And just that will make you think of the ni'mah that you have. As-sihhatu tajun ala ru'usil as-sihha. La yarahu illa al-marda. When you are well, when you are fit, it's a crown on your head. Only the sick people sees it. There are some people who wish they can just say a word. There are some people who feel and wish they can see the dunya for just 1 minute. Some people who used to be fit and well, they can do everything for themselves. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests them, put them housebound. They cannot move. They cannot do anything for themselves. They have to be fed. They have to be chained. They have to be spoken to. They cannot even reply. But you know you have the opportunity. Remember, we are talking about taking opportunity. You are well, you are fit. What are you doing? Are you using this time to obey Allah, to increase your good deeds, to become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, finding your Jannah? Or are you using that time to disobey Allah, to become someone who is mischievous, to become someone who is evil in society? Whenever you say something, people say, A'udhu Billah. You go somewhere, people say, we don't want him here. Is that who you are? We have to make sure that the opportunity that we have in front of us, we use it to the best of our ability. We do not let it go by without doing something about it. Because when the time goes, it is done, it is finished, it will not come back. It will not come back. And so when you are fit, you can come to the masjid. Why can't you come? You can pray standing with the jama'ah. Why can't you do it? Maybe you wait until it's Juma, you come to the masjid. If it's not Juma, you don't come to the masjid. And you are fit, you are well. Why is that? The community needs you. You've got skills that they want. You say, I'm too busy for the community. I have got my own personal business, my own personal issues. I can't be bothered. When you can't do anything and they say, I wish I could do this for them, it's too late. Let us take advantage of that. It is so important that we could not leave it. We cannot leave it behind. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went on further to say, your wealth before your poverty. When we talk about wealth, sometimes people think about, I want to be a millionaire. But when you're talking about wealth, we want ghina nafs, the first place. What is that? Contentment. You are happy with whatever little that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to you. You are happy and pleased with what Allah has provided for you. My dear brother, alhamdulillah, you eat 3 meals a day, maybe 4, and in between 10 snacks. Right? Every 5 minutes, oh, I'm peckish. Eat something. Crisp, biscuit, cake, chocolate, and the rest of it. That doesn't count in the 3 main meals, right? What about our brothers and sisters who cannot afford a meal a day? Have you thought about them? Wallahi, there are people when it is Fajr, they start to think, what am I going to eat today? They don't have it. They don't have it. They are just going out and say, we live in bi'idhnillah. If we get, we eat. If we don't get, alhamdulillah. What about those in Syria? You can see every day. Today they are here, in the afternoon they don't know where they're going to be. And they do not know whether they're going to have a meal or not. Except someone hands them out to them. You eat your breakfast, you eat your lunch, you eat your dinner. Did you say alhamdulillah? You don't even think about it. Even our children, when you provide the food to them, they don't even think about saying alhamdulillah, I don't like it. I want something else. Think about the children who cannot afford food. And when it's given to you, you eat it and say alhamdulillah. We need to take and learn from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet never criticized food. If he likes it, he will eat it. If he doesn't like it, he doesn't make a comment about it. But these days, it is too spicy, it is too hot, no, it is cold, I don't like this, I like that. This is what we're talking about. When you have it, show the gratitude, show the appreciation. And when Allah has provided for you whatever little it is, think about the next person. Don't be too selfish. Think that no matter how small what you have, you are better than millions. You are better than more and more people. So the little that you have, think about sharing it. Think about helping others with it. The little that you give, Allah will put barakah in it for you. He will replace it for you. Remember, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, "Ma naqasa min mali muslimin sadaqa." Charity will never reduce the wealth of a believer. If you do not believe in these things, they don't work for you. You have to believe that this is the Prophet who said it. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. The Prophet will never say something out of his own whim, out of his own desire. These are revelations that are given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so when he says to you that your wealth will not decrease because of sadaqah, you should believe. And you should give. When we are asked to donate fi sabilillah in the masjid, we should not be pinching the money from the pocket. You know, we try to look for the coins. And we try to look for the least change to give. No, give the best of your wealth. Think about those companions who sacrificed their life and their wealth for the spread of the deen. What did you do? What about if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you go bankrupt and he takes back all this wealth from you, like he gave Qarun, and then he destroyed Qarun and his wealth altogether? He's capable of doing that. What if Allah takes the wealth from you again? What would you say? You see, Allah narrates to us in the Quran about the people who disbelieve and they go to the Akhirah. Now their wish is that they will be returned back to dunya, and the first thing they mention, for as-saddaq, so that I can give charity. Why? Because of the enormous reward that they have seen being given to people who gave charity in the dunya. So therefore, your wealth before your poverty. The time that you have to give. Sometimes giving back to community does not only mean money. It comes in different forms. Whatever you can give back to community, give back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also said, we've talked about his youth before his old age, and we have also spoken about his wealth before his poverty, and his good health and money. And he also says, your life before your death. Obviously, That is the seal, and that is the end. If you have not done what is required of you to do until the moment has come for the angel of death to come and take your soul, do you think you have enough time to go back and say, I'm going to go and start to be nice, to pray, to fast, to give charity? When the time comes for the soul to be taken away, it will not be delayed. It will not be postponed. Nothing will hold that back. Everything will come to an end for you, will cease. That will be the end of you. And so, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has reminded us to pay attention to this thing called death. He says to us, "Akthiru min dhikri hadhihi al-ladhat." Akthiru, a lot. Think a lot about the destroyer of all pleasures. Because when you're living, you think you're enjoying the dunya. You think you're enjoying with your family. You think you're enjoying your wealth. You're enjoying your children. But when death comes, none of these will save you, will protect you, will help you. You will have to depart. You will have to go. And this is why when you prepare yourself and say to yourself, I could leave this world at any time, it inspires you to do good. It tells you that this dunya is faniya. It tells you that the accountability is coming. It tells you to prepare. It could be any minute from now. So therefore, we should not be scared of saying, you might be dying tomorrow. Because definitely we all believe that we will die one day. The question that we ask ourselves is when, which we don't know. And so the best way to prepare is to be alert all the time. If Allah was to take me now, that I'm ready and happy to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should not be or put yourself in a position wherein you feel, if I were to meet Allah, I would be ashamed. If I were to meet Allah now, Allah will not be happy with me. If I were to meet Allah now, I would regret my life. My dear brothers and sisters, may Allah forgive our shortcomings. May Allah guide us to what is best for us in our lives. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us true believers and make us die upon the coming of the Tawheed. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه من كل ذنب إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على نبي المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى أما بعد. We reminded ourselves of the golden advice that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave to this wonderful companion Abu Dharr al-Ghifari رضي الله تعالى عنه, and he says to him, take advantage of five things before five: your youth, before your old age, your health before your sickness, and then he also says your wealth before your poverty, and then we talk about death, life before death. And then the last one is that your free time before you become too busy. You know, these days everybody asks, I'm too busy, brother, I don't have time. Everybody is busy. And the children also, you tell them, I'm too busy, I've got too much homework. And life never gets easier if that's the way you look at it. As a young child going to school, you'll be giving homework, you have to go to school, come back, do homework, that's it. And sometimes do some chores at home, right? That's the life for you. As an adult, you have to go and find money, you have to come home, look after the family, that's the life for you. Right? As an old man, people have to look after you. You can't even look after yourself. So when do you have time? You have to make time. The time that you have is precious. You should never waste it. You should never waste it. And this is what the Arab saying goes by, Allah safe. The time is like a sword. You have it, you're playing with it. Right? It might chop you off. Maybe by accident. You wouldn't realize you are wasting your time until by the time you wake up, you say, oh, subhanAllah, I didn't know. You can use your time effectively. Simple tips that we can all use to make sure we are efficient in what we do. When you wake up in the morning, you have to ask yourself, what am I planning to do today? Children have got 1 week of half time. What were they doing all the whole week? Were you just running up and down? You let them play on the games and then go out to the park and come back? Or did they do something constructive with that time? As parents, we need to guide them. We need to help them. We need to support them. As adults, what is our relationship with the Quran? We need to use time. Maybe every day one page, half a page. Okay, two lines. We don't have time. But make it a habit that you're doing something constructive every day. Small, simple things. Khairul umur adwamuha wa in qalb. The best of the things that we can do are the ones that are continuous, even if they are small good deeds that we do. Let us just keep doing them. So therefore, I remind myself, I remind you all, what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said to us. Ihris ala ma yanfa'ak. Pay attention and occupy yourself with things that will benefit you. Wasta'in billah, and seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wala ta'jaz. Don't give up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins and forgive our mistakes. Amen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide our children to become successful leaders of this ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us wherever we may be. Those people who are struggling, wherever they are, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for them. And those people who are sick, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure them. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those people who have gone beyond, may Allah have mercy upon them. Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes our lives, may He make us become true believers, strong believers, and firm believers. May we die upon the kalimat of tawheed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us before He takes our own souls. Allahumma rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiu alim. Wa tub alayna maulana innaka tawwabur rahim. Allahumma rabbana ati nufusana taqwaha wa zakkiha wa anta khayru man zakkaha. Allahumma rabbana hab lana min azwajina wa dhurriyyatina qurrata a'yun waj'alna للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. عباد الله قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله.